Hi, everyone. This is Dina Sokolow, and I'm with my law partner, Larry Eastwood, and we are going to talk about sexual harassment today. We're very excited about how many people we have on this webinar. We know this is a very hot issue now, and hopefully we're going to address some of your concerns about what to do now that this is being so heavily discussed in the workplace and outside, and what does it mean for you as employers. And we're going to give you some tips, and we're going to talk about how this news cycle is affecting your actions and your employees' reactions to it, and give you some guidelines as to what we think are some best practices. So before we get started substantively, we've got just a few housekeeping things. We do have a Q&A box, and I'm going to answer a question that we always get for every webinar. You will get a copy of these slides. You'll receive a thank you email after the completion of the seminar, and so you will have a copy of it. This is also being recorded and will be posted on Baker Donaldson's website, so you'll be able to also listen to it again if you want to. There is a blue survey box. We ask that you complete the survey. We like to hear your feedback, and it also asks about we're planning this upcoming year's webinar, so we are interested in your input on what you'd like to hear about. If you have any questions or technical issues, go ahead and put it in the Q&A, and we will try to address those. So let's get started. When we're talking about sexual harassment, we can't turn on the news today without seeing it. Seeing a news story about a prominent person that has been accused of sexual harassment in recent months. It's staggering, really. And with each story, we're hearing these sordid, troubling accounts from these victims. And we're also hearing that some of these victims had complained in the past, and their complaints were not taken seriously. So we're gonna talk about that when we talk a little bit more detail about what happened with Matt Lauer of the Today Show. But even though it's making the news right now and it's on everybody's minds and it's a water cooler conversation, this is nothing new. This is sexual harassment in the workplace has obviously been around for a long time, and it's been an issue that employers have been grappling with for a long time. And in most cases the people aren't famous, and a lot of times the victims don't come forward, or they're discouraged from coming forward, or they're frightened to come forward. And one of the things that I found really interesting when we were preparing for this is so many of, with these allegations, with these famous people, there comes another allegation or indictment that everybody knew about some of these harassers, that people dismissed it, or they were, or they were frightened to say anything because they were fearing retaliation, or they were embarrassed, or there was a power differential between the person who was doing the harassment and the person being harassed, and they felt like they couldn't speak. And so that's something that we're going to talk about today, about those bystanders, and is the fact that these cases that are coming forward now, are we going to see a different, are people feeling, are victims feeling more empowered to come forward because of this? It's a question that everyone keeps asking, and why now? Why are these people coming forward now? Why are we hearing about this in the news? Why is this making news? I mean, if these complaints have been going on for years, why is this happening now? And Larry and I were talking about this today about, does everyone remember this person, Anita Hill? She was a 35-year-old law professor, and she sat in front of the U.S. Judiciary Committee in 1991 to testify about sexual harassment. And Larry and I, Larry, you might want to comment on this, talked about how different it was in 1991 to today.
It really was. This was during the Clarence Thomas confirmation proceedings in the Senate. And Anita Hill was subject to some very pointed questions, really withering questions, that probably would create so much furor today that the senators posing those same questions to an interviewee would be in in danger of getting in some serious trouble in the media and with their constituents. So times have really changed in terms of what the state of the law is and the state of public perception in this area. And really, Dina, it's been an extraordinary year and a half. It was mid-2016 when Roger Ailes was sued by Gretchen Carlson, former Fox News host and also a former Miss America. And that has set in motion this domino effect where now we've seen it go through network news, into Hollywood, into television, into every aspect of media and even Congress. And people have lost their jobs and perhaps even had careers ruined. So some would say for many of these people, deservedly so perhaps. It really has been an extraordinary year and a half, and we're beginning to see the consequences bleed into the workplace with people who, as you say, are not famous, but who have reputations to uphold, and people who are victims or potential victims who would like to have justice.
I agree. And if you look, these are some of the questions that they were actually the G version questions versus some of the other questions that I didn't feel were appropriate to put on this. But these were some of the questions that Anita Hill was asked. And this was truly a he said, she said, because Clarence Thomas flat out denied it and said he cannot imagine anything that he said or did that she could have construed as harassment. You know, we are in, just like Larry said, this is an extraordinary time. We're in just a new, you know, a new climate and even possibly a cultural change. You know, when we look at Time Magazine, Person of the Year being women who have come forward and this movement of, you know, the hashtag Me Too. I mean, if anybody watched the Golden Globes, we saw everybody in black with pins that said Time's Up. And, you know, we're in a different age, you know, from 1991 to today and where we were. And after, you know, they called it the Anita Hill effect. After Anita Hill's testimony in 1991, the following year, the EEOC almost doubled the number of sexual harassment complaints that they had received. We saw a rise in the number of lawsuits alleging sexual harassment, and more women ran for public office that year than had in the past. So there was her testimony and that focus on sexual harassment caused a chain of events that you know, was much broader than just her testimony before the Senate Judiciary Committee. And we're going to likely see that now. With the news cycle constantly reporting this and with the famous players involved and the movement that seems to be started by some very famous people, I believe we're going to see that have that resonate beyond just what is happening in Hollywood. We're going to likely see more people coming forward, you know, and promoting change. And some of these, you know, it's easy to just have a hashtag movement, but we're also seeing people promoting more legislation to try to address harassment in the workplace. And the question that still remains is whether these movements are going to, you know, is it going to impact harassment cases before judges? Are we going to see an effect on juries? What, you know, the where this is going to go is still yet to be seen, but I believe that we are definitely, and I believe that's one of the reasons why we have so many people on this this webinar today, is because you're feeling the impacts of it, that it is now a discussion that we're seeing take place, you know, with our employees and with our managers, and you know, we want to make sure that we are arming them and addressing this, so to help address this issue and the consequences of it. You know, Title VII was enacted in 1964, And Title VII is where we have sex discrimination, race, national origin, religion. And we see harassment, obviously, beyond just sexual harassment. You can have harassment under any of the federal laws, whether it's age or disability. But sexual harassment we did not see until a Supreme Court case in 1986. And today, even decades later, it still is a stubborn presence in the workplace. We're still seeing sexual harassment charges, you know, keeping pretty much a steady pace. These are the number of sexual harassment charges received by the EEOC. Now, it's interesting. I don't know where they got their figure from, but the EEOC estimates that about 75% of all workplace harassment goes unreported. And so that's if that's the case, that there's 75% of the people who are experiencing harassment or feel they're experiencing harassment are not reporting it, are we going to, you know, is this number, you know, the number that's hovering around 13,000, are we going to see that number increase? And I believe we are, just based on the current climate that we're seeing regarding sexual harassment claims that are so public.
Right. We're waiting for the EEOC to publish their 2017 figures on this. Many of us predict they will spike, and we certainly are seeing different kinds of behaviors. When I do trainings, I finished training a big company here in Nashville. I trained over 1,000 employees recently. The kinds of pointed questions I got about sexual harassment during that harassment training were remarkable. They were different, pointed in ways that I had not previously seen, clearly inspired by what's going on in the news.
Well, and I agree with you. I think it'll be very interesting to see what the EEOC's numbers are coming for the fiscal year 2017 and also in the upcoming year. Well, as we said in the title of this training, we're going to talk about – there was lots of different people we could choose from, but we decided to talk about the situation with Matt Lauer because I think there's some interesting lessons. Larry and I were talking about this right before we got on the webinar about things that NBC did correctly and things that they did not do correctly. You know, it was. I think the world was stunned when Matt Lauer was terminated. The Today Show has been number one in the rating. He's paid $25 million a year and was considered their star, their linchpin of their news division. But an employee complained about inappropriate sexual conduct on a trip dating back to the Sochi Olympics in 2014 that continued for several months, but at the same time, NBC was getting pressure to do something because Variety, the news organization that publishes Variety, had been investigating him and had several women who had made allegations about him. And one of the things I thought that was really disturbing when I was, besides what the allegations were of what he did, one of the things I found very disturbing was that many of these women reported that they had complained about him and complained to deaf ears. So let's talk a little bit about what the allegations were against him. I'm not going to go through each one of these. I'm just going to kind of show you the slides. But they were pretty. There were some pretty horrific allegations against him. Everyone said that he had a button under his desk that locked his door, and there were allegations that he had actually locked some women in his office while he was harassing them. And this is some of his allegations, and it ranged from lewd comments to acts that he did and exposing himself and all this stuff. So the question was, okay, they're faced with all these allegations. They're getting pressure from a news organization that they're going to expose him. And, sorry, that's probably a poor phrase, expose him, that they were going to write about this situation. And so what was the NBC's response? Well, NBC's response was to conduct an investigation and then to fire him. But this is after they had received tremendous pressure on this, and it was given One consideration that came into play was the fact that this was all in the news, that this was in a time these women were coming forward and this story was going to be released right when all the other stories from everybody from, as Larry mentioned, Roger Ailes and Bill O'Reilly to Mario Batali and Kevin Spacey and obviously Harvey Weinstein. And so we're hearing all of these stories. And so I think NBC felt a lot of pressure about doing it. After that, they also issued mandatory harassment training for all of their employees, and they apparently are requiring this annually. They brought in an outside consultant to do cultural assessment of their culture, of how people are reacting. I'm not sure what they're doing with the cultural assessment, but I understand that they have brought in a third-party organization to look at their culture and help them address how they want their culture to be. And now this, I have a question mark next to it, whether it's a new harassment policy, because it has been widely reported that from supposedly some employees that NBC has dramatically changed their harassment policy. But I was unable to we looked everywhere to try to get a copy of it, but this is what has been widely reported, that they no longer have any kind of tolerance for workplace romances, that if people start dating, they are required to leave the company. They actually addressed what is an acceptable hug, that it is a quick movement and an immediate release. I know it's not funny, but I was joking. I'm like, is a side hug okay? Air kisses. I mean, it's interesting that they've gone so far. Larry, were you going to say something?
No, go ahead.
Okay. But they have strict rules about socializing. They're not to share taxis home. There's rules about meals after work together. And they have basically now, laid down the gauntlet. If we find out that there was any kind of harassing behavior and you knew about it, even as a third party, and didn't report it, you're going to be terminated. So, it leaves us asking, is this necessary now? Do we have to legislate and have policies and rules over every interaction between our employees? And I'm not sure I have the answer to that. I mean, Larry, what do you think?
Well, I have a couple of thoughts. One, these are spectacularly bad facts. I've been practicing law in the employment area for almost 25 years, and only early in my career did I have cases where people were dropping their pants and doing things like Matt Lauer and many of these other people have been accused of doing. It tells me that culturally a lot of things that were perhaps should have always been unacceptable but were wrongly countenanced and allowed aren't allowed anymore, and that training has worked. All the things that many of the people on the call today are involved with, whether you're an owner of a company, whether you're a stakeholder in the human resources department, maybe you're an attorney, all of these things that we've been doing and touting as best practices, including training and how we handle our open door policies and our investigations, things we're going to be talking about in a minute, they have worked and they have helped to some extent, because it is very unusual in our experience, Dina, to have spectacularly bad facts like this very often. Yet you saw it infused all through many different companies in the media. It's also very interesting that a company as big as NBC, with as much at stake as they have, apparently didn't have any kind of anti-harassment training program to begin with. The final thing that's remarkable is how, I would say, over the top some of these things are, if they are true. It really is unusual if someone says things like, absolutely no workplace romances, period, at a company as big as NBC. Now, I'll confess, this is kind of near and dear to my heart, because I met my wife, whom I've been married to for over 20 years, at a big law firm in Atlanta. So, I think that if people are well-behaved and act like adults, workplace romance can be wonderful. It's produced a long marriage and two great kids for us. But if you're telling people you can't have any kind of workplace romance and you can't even share a taxi home, or you're naughty and you're going to be written up or fired perhaps, that's a very extreme environment compared to other companies. I'm not advocating you go this far, but it is the sort of thing, if it's true, that maybe is a reaction, an overreaction to an overly permissive culture that didn't train at all.
Yeah, I think that's a good point. Yeah, I think that's a good point. And we've had a couple people ask, why did it take NBC so long? And I mean, I'm only guessing, but I'm assuming that they were protecting an asset they had, that Matt Lauer was number one in his slot, I read somewhere that they said that the revenue that they received from advertising in the Today Show, for the Today Show, was the highest of almost all of their regular shows, I believe, you know, and that's one of the things that we need to talk about and look at is, you know, what happens when you don't, you ignore it, or when, you know, as Larry said, you know, we don't see these kind of horrible, I mean, some of the facts about what these men have been accused of, these famous men have been accused of, are just terrific. And that's, you know, that's a rare thing. But the question is also, you know, and I think we'll see it, we'll find out in the upcoming years, is have these things actually happened outside of these, you know, in workplaces that people have just been scared to come forward or say? I guess that remains to be seen. So I think NBC was just, their hand was forced. So what does this all mean? You know, I made my own hashtag of you two instead of me two. You know, what should we be doing now? We're going to talk about four things that, and we're not reinventing the wheel here. We're going to talk about things you probably are considering yourselves, but we're going to talk about, how do we look at these things in light of what is going on? We're going to talk about your policies, your training, investigations, and then we're going to talk about some other, you know, the news and publicity regarding these allegations that employees might have. So our step one is you two should be taking a look at your anti-harassment policy. I know it's a given, and I'm sure all of you have it, that everyone has a well-drafted anti-harassment policy that's posted and regularly communicated. And one of the things that's so important about it is it provides a framework to tell the employees what, you know, not only the law, but what your policy is. What, you know, what do you want your culture to be? And I'm going to sort of hammer this because I think it's really important, besides just sort of addressing anecdotally, you know, harassment and treating each other with respect. What do we want our culture to be? And I think Larry even referenced NBC. Was this a culture where it was just sort of permissive, where they were letting people kind of, you know, there was no training, there was no kind of communication of here's what we expect our employees, how we expect our employees to behave in the workplace and to treat each other. You know, what's our values? What kind of work environment do we want to foster? And it starts at the top. You've got to decide what you want that to be, and your harassment and anti-discrimination policy should mirror that. You know, and one thing we've talked about, I have severe and pervasive here, but it's really or pervasive. But you know, the law of sexual harassment has not changed. When you have harassment, the standard of what has to, what you have to allege and what you have to prove a case of sexual harassment under federal law has not changed. It has to be severe or pervasive, meaning it has to either be something that's really, really bad, or it has to be something that's maybe a lower level, but it is happening over a period of time. For something to be illegal under federal law. And that's the same today as it was before all these people came forward. It has not changed. But what we find, and Larry, you can comment on this too, is that most companies' policies on anti-harassment are broader than what the law says. So somebody, you might have an action that you find unacceptable in your workplace and you want to prohibit, that if it happened and the person sued, it might not be enough to be sexual harassment under the law, but that doesn't mean if it's a violation of your policy, you can take action based on a violation of your own policy. Larry, you want to
fully agree, and just to augment that, I want to say that I encourage my clients to have a higher standard that they hold people to, not the minimum standard of, could we win a lawsuit if someone sued us over this? I often say, think about someone you admire in your family. Maybe it's your grandma. Unless you have sort of a pervy grandma, hopefully you have a grandma who's wholesome and nice. Your behavior that we expect in the workplace ought to mirror the standards of decency and good conduct that hopefully we were all taught from a young age about how one ought to behave. Holding people to that and communicating that you expect that is a lot easier for people to understand than trying to explain the intricacies of Title VII and whether we could win a lawsuit or not. That's about risk management in a legal construct, not about what we ought to be doing in the workplace. I think you should always shoot for the higher standard and tell people this.
You know, and one of the things I always preach is having what I call, for lack of a better word, a live policy. I think almost everybody can find this language in your handbook or in your policies, that we do not tolerate harassment or inappropriate conduct. Okay, but the question is it just words? You know, when we have a live policy, we're not just having a policy in a handbook that somebody signs off on when they are hired. We put it in a drawer somewhere, and if you asked anybody to quote it, or you asked what the terms were, you asked your management, they really don't know. You know, oh, I think we did sign something like that when we first started. And so a live policy is not just, you know, I talked before about culture. Is it integrated into the culture so that we, you know, your employees from your highest exec to your, you know, to your rank and file, that does everybody know that that's the culture, so that certain behavior that's violative of the policy and that high standard that Larry talked about is regarded as intolerable and people know to report it. And, you know, somebody asked me, what's that egregious, what is egregious? You know, what is that severe? Is it assault? Is it? It could be something short of assault to be illegal harassment. I mean, it's hard to tell you an example of what is egregious because the courts are different on what the standard is to be severe. But regardless, you know, what we're looking at, you know, when we have these, in my experience, the cases that I've defended, it's very rare for us to see a person have an allegation of just one action. It's usually several things that have happened to the victim. And one thing to keep in mind too, you know, because it's been prominent women that have come forward accusing prominent men, we've been talking about it in terms of victims being women, but, you know, with Kevin Spacey, the allegation was that he had harassed a male. We can have male-on-male harassment. We can have females harassing men. We can have women harassing women. It is not just men harassing women. So, you know, when we talk about the policy and integrating it and regularly communicating it, part of that's going to come through, and we're going to talk about it in a minute, through training and through discussions with your managers, you know, about when you have meetings with your managers, are you talking about how people are treating each other and what are, you know, what type of interaction are we seeing between our employees, and assess the unique risk you have for your organization. Do you have an organization where people are traveling together a lot? Do you have an organization where you've got teams together, and, you know, where people are working outside of a workplace together? You know, one of the things you want to do is look at the unique elements of your situation in your organization, and, you know, we want to regularly evaluate, is our program, is our training, is our policies effective? And we want to touch base with the employees and ask them, you know, and our managers, you know, what do you think? Do we need to be addressing something different? So I've sort of just summarized 8 elements that I think should be in every anti-harassment policy. And obviously the first one is that we have a zero tolerance. You know, we need to tell them an unequivocal statement that harassment of any kind is not tolerated. That's just a given that should be in any anti-harassment policy. And the other thing we want to define for them is what do we consider harassment? I mean, I think that's been a question that people ask, and I know even from managers' viewpoints, they're saying, well, what can I do? What can I talk to these employees about? Where would I draw the line? You know, where am I possibly, you know, violating this? So we want to give some clear parameters. We need to be very specific about what conduct is considered improper harassment. Easy to understand description of it, you know. And, you know, if we're going to have a policy and a culture and a practice against this sexual harassment, if we want it to be successful, we've got to have clear lines about what kind of interaction and conduct is forbidden. And so how do we do that besides kind of a general description? We also want to give examples, you know, provide specific examples of conducts that would be considered harassment under the policy. Also, you know, I talked about that NBC is now has this, you know, very bright line in the sand of a duty to report and that you will be terminated if they find out you knew about it. I wonder how that will play in. I mean, how that will actually come. I'm sorry, I'm using poor words, but how will that play out in a workplace when somebody has brought an allegation and saying that people knew about it and they're claiming they didn't know about it? But we do want to emphasize that there is a duty to report. Larry, what do you think?
I think this is the freshest trend among these eight elements you've identified. More and more companies are moving from encouraging to requiring employees to report things, and I think it's a wise move. I think that the way you reinforce a lot of these things is not just having it in your policy, but through training, as you're going to talk about in a minute.
I agree. I mean, I think we're seeing this, and it makes it also a very clear line for employees that it's not a matter of we'd like you to report. We're telling them what they need to do, that they're part of this process. And that kind of goes along with what I was talking about before about the culture, that we all are part of the culture that we want, a culture of respect. A culture where we're treating our coworkers well, and part of that is, well, here is your responsibility and your part in that process is to timely and accurately report the harassment. We want to make sure that when we're telling them this is whether they feel that they have been harassed or somebody else has been harassed, that it is timely, that they are reporting it. You know, that they're not waiting to see what happens, that they're actually telling us when this happens, that, and we want that language to be part of our policies, that not only do we want you to report it, but you need to timely report it. Also, and Larry's going to talk a little bit more about this in detail, but we definitely want to have a very well-defined and accessible complaint procedure. Every step should be spelled out with multiple avenues for reporting, not just that they're going to HR, but we give the employee, because for various reasons employees don't report because of maybe a personal relationship they have with somebody, or because they don't feel comfortable, or maybe the person, if it's direct reporting, that they feel that the manager is the person they feel is harassing them. So we want to have multiple avenues for reporting and the complaint procedure to be very well defined, and it educate and encourage employees to come forward and identify risky behavior in the workplace. The next element we want in every single policy is that we have no retaliation. You know, a lot of times we see with sexual harassment complaints that their power moves by a supervisor over a subordinate. It's very common to hear an employee complaining about a manager. We want to encourage people, and it's all part of having people come forward, is that you will not have – we're going to protect you against any vengeful or retaliatory acts by anybody because you have reported or because you have been part of an investigation, because you have been a witness. Also, we want to have an explanation of confidentiality. You know, we want to discuss the level of confidentiality. And generally what policies say is we will keep – to the extent we can, we will keep this confidential. We never want to promise absolute confidentiality, because there are many times where it just cannot, you can't honor it. And so we don't want to promise complete confidentiality. I mean, if somebody was attacked, we may have to get law enforcement involved. And even if it's something lesser than that, we may need to be talking to managers. Things might have to be moved around. We might have to take some remedial measures, and Larry's going to talk about that later. But, and so people will have to know. And so what we want to say is that to the extent practicable, we're going to try to keep this confidential. And the final thing is that we want to have clear consequences for violations, for harassing conduct, for retaliatory conduct, for failure to report. And I have a question mark there because that's going to be a question of whether, you know, when we have this mandatory reporting, are we going to have that employees can be disciplined up to termination for failure to report. So those are the items that we think we strongly encourage you to take a look at your policies, and if you have counsel, possibly to have your counsel take a look at it and see, you know, is this policy, are anti-harassment policies, is it something we probably need to update? Is it clear to our employees? Do employees know what is prohibited and where to go if they feel they're being harassed? So the second thing we're going to talk about is training and how do we get our message out besides having a policy that is readily available and we have people sign off on it and we talk about it and it's our culture, but how do we really get the word out about what we want? And training is the best way to do that. In June of 2016, the EEOC released a 130-page report on harassment in the workplace. And you can find it on the EEOC's website. If you did June 2016 harassment in the workplace, the report will come out. Or if anybody would like a link, I'll have my email at the end. You can email me, and I will send you a link to it. It's pretty lengthy. But in it, they have 45 recommendations regarding ways employers can both prevent harassment in the workplace and address it. And they have 12 risk factors concerning workplace harassment and its prevention. But a considerable part of the report centers on the role of effective compliance training. And it's interesting now because, you know, with this news cycle and these news stories coming forward about these famous people being accused, there's a lot of talk about training and its effectiveness. You know, does it work to put an employee in front of a computer and have them do an online training? Does it work to have managers do it? You know, what is effective? You know, are we doing it just because it helps us with a defense in a sexual harassment claim that we've trained our employees, or are we really trying to get a cultural message out? And the EEOC has an opinion about it. They say that they've identified that live interactive training is the preferred method of training. It's the most effective. And they even talk about what trainers have to, you know, they go a little further. They say, well, not only that, the trainers have to be dynamic, engaging, and have a full command of the subject matter. So they don't say who that is, but that is what they have found to be the most effective form of getting harassment training communicated to employees. So the next thing the EEOC says is, okay, well, we've got some elements of what would be successful harassment training. These are elements that we think should be in every training. Training that not only helps employers comply with the legal requirements of non-discrimination laws, but also, and I had just talked about this, describes conduct that left unchecked might rise to the level of illegal harassment. And so that would go to what your policy is. You know, we have we just talked about this in terms of the anti-harassment policy. We want to define specifically what conduct is prohibited, and we want to give examples of it, and then we want to train on it. And training that's not canned, one size fits all, but is tailored to the specific realities at different workplaces. And this has always been something that throughout my career I have been a big proponent of, because I think that a lot of times we can talk about, you know, harassment or anti-discrimination from a 30,000-foot level, but when we talk about it more specifically to your industry, your workplace, your policies, the realities of how your people interact, it's so much more effective when it is tailored to your particular workplace. Also, one of the things that EEOC mentioned was training in multiple languages or for different learning styles or levels of education. We want to be sensitive to that as well. Also, training that clarifies conduct that is not harassment and acceptable in the workplace. You know, that they said, I thought this was interesting, reflecting the reality of human experience and common courtesy. So where we say that there are things that we might prohibit and that we don't allow, but that we're not telling people not to interact and be friendly with each other and you know, enjoy their workplace. What do we allow? You know, also about their responsibility. And that's one of the things, you know, I mentioned before with the anti-harassment policy with reporting, that we want employees to understand it's their responsibility to report, that they have a part in this whole process and this whole culture. They have a duty, too. They have a duty to report. They have a duty to refrain from behavior that's harassing. So what is their... You know, what are their duties? And also, you know, here the EEOC mentions what I had mentioned before, that there's multiple avenues offered to by the employer to report the conduct. Also, that the training goes through the complaint procedure. So those were the six items that the EEOC mentioned that they see would be are necessary in sexual harassment training. Now, when I talk about training, I think part of it is that we're not just training, we're trying to educate. You know, the key to a great harassment training is that we're giving a curriculum that's clear, it's relevant to our workforce, and it's promoting a safe dialogue. It's letting employees know that we want to hear from you if you think that this is going on because it's not acceptable in our workplace and we want to eradicate it. So, you know, you want to look at your training materials and your delivery methods to ensure that your anti-harassment training addresses your unique characteristics and your organizational culture, you know, and what methods are used to make the training interactive and dynamic so the employees remember it. Also, who's doing your training? Are they sufficiently dynamic and engaging, or do we just have a manager kind of going over our policy that the employees are sitting there and wondering when lunch starts? You know, does the trainer have full command of the subject matter to answer questions and to have a back, you know, an interaction with the employees? You know, and one of the things, I think this goes to back what I was saying about culture. You know, we want the training messages and our how we're delivering this to go beyond just compliance. I mean, we want to talk about what our culture is, you know, that we want the workplace civility, respect, you know, bystander intervention. We don't want you to sit by and let this happen if you are witnessing this. So it's training besides educating on our policies also helps promote our culture. And, you know, you may even want to consider executive coaching for those who feel, you know, maybe for your higher ups that feel that they need further instruction or may be more vulnerable to a claim, or group executive coaching. That's another thing you may want to consider. But, you know, the main point is that we want to make sure you're communicating your harassment policy, in particular details about how to report observed harassment frequently in variety of forms and methods. And so formal training, I definitely recommend a minimum of doing it annually. If you can have it recorded, that's great for your new employees that are hired in the interim. And then we also just want to make sure that we are touching base with our employees and asking how – how do we do? What did you think of the training? Now, I got this. This is actually, and I have the site on the bottom to the study that the New York Times posted, that they say that it should be 4 hours in person and tailored to the workplace. I don't know if that is necessary, but it is. There was a study that showed that's the most effective training that the New York Times discussed. But I know we've received several questions about training specifics, and Larry and I are going to stay on at the end for another 10 minutes to try to answer some of these questions. But I'm going to go ahead and hand it off to Larry now to talk about the complaint and investigation procedures.
Great. Thank you, Dina. So now we're at the point where we're going to talk about our investigation approach and what we can do to minimize our risk and also affect the kind of positive change and reaction that we want to, so our company will be well managed. The first thing we want to do is make sure that we take all complaints seriously. And increasingly, there are people who are coming out of the woodwork, I guess you could say, and raising things that happened in the past. It's not just in the workplace. We're seeing this in the news. I think yesterday a story broke on the national news front where a pastor in Memphis had been accused of what would have amounted to perhaps statutory rape, if I have the ages correct, that would have happened 20 years ago. This is not an employment situation, but it does sort of overarch everything we're talking about. And he came out and apologized to his congregation, and there were people who were critical about the way he did that. Other people praised it. But the point is, something that happened decades ago can be fair game for being brought up in an accusatory way. Now, we have statutes of limitations. Under Title VII, you have about 10 months to bring a claim to the EEOC. If it's not a continuing violation, that 10-month statute of limitations works for you. In many states, there are longer statutes of limitations. So I'm not saying you're necessarily facing liability for these things in the past that are brought up, but I do think it's important to the way you're perceived by your employees and your culture and to possible publicity to take complaints seriously and look into them no matter how old they are. And that involves, as we look at these keys to successfully handling this part of our efforts, we need to always do a prompt and thorough investigation when one is called for. We'll talk a little bit about that in a minute. Afterwards, we need to take appropriate remedial action if that's what's called for. We always want to try to report back to the complaining party. Otherwise, they don't feel like their complaint has been taken seriously and addressed. And then we want to handle publicity. And this is an important new feature of what's going on, not just with the advent of social media, but with what's been happening for the last year and a half. Let's talk first of all about this investigation checklist slide. First question, a threshold question is, do we need to investigate? We're not suggesting that every time an employee comes forward and says, maybe for the multiple time, hey, so-and-so is bothering me. Well, what are they doing? Well, you know, they know that I don't like their Furby, and they're putting their Furby up on the ledge next to where I can see it, right? I'm not saying that we need to be intrepid every time somebody makes an allegation and tries to couch it in terms of some kind of harassing or unlawful behavior, that we have to react the same way. But it is important to make sure that when a complaint is something that might violate Title VII and when perception calls for it, we do conduct an investigation, and it should have similar elements. One thing is we need to make sure the person who's conducting the investigation is well-trained and is the right person for the job. Sometimes you get outside attorneys to do this. Know that if you do that, your outside counsel may be disqualified from handling any subsequent litigation that might arise. So consider that when you're deciding whether to farm out the investigation. And, of course, it's expensive to hire outside counsel to do this. Certain circumstances really do call for it. I think this is something you can decide in tandem with your in-house or outside attorneys. It's nice to preserve the privilege when you have outside counsel doing the investigation. That's the attorney-client privilege. One thing I often will tell my clients to do, I say when you're deciding who's going to do the investigation, hopefully it's someone you've trained and who knows what they're doing. Maybe this isn't their first time doing this sort of thing. I tend to send people in pairs. I think it's easier so that we don't get into a swearing contest about what was allegedly said during the meetings to have at least two people there. I think you have to be careful if you're the person recording this or if you're supervising them as you take notes about facts, not legal conclusions. You need to be careful about drafts and what happens with them and about whether you're creating a record that could be used against you in ways that aren't necessary. For instance, let's say you go and interview a witness and they start telling you about something completely separate that happened with another employee. Probably a good idea to start a separate investigation and to compartmentalize any notes about that. Sometimes what I tell people to do is prepare a set of notes about their interviews, if they're doing their own interviews, and send it to my attention as their outside attorney. That would be privileged, and we can be in a position then to take that draft and turn it into something carefully worded, appropriately worded, and permanent that we would use as evidence in the case. So that's something to consider. You always want to try and interview the accuser But sometimes the accuser has left the company or has a lawyer and refuses to talk to you. So you have to adjust when those are the facts. But ideally, you start with the accuser, you find out what it is specifically they're complaining about, in particular, who the witnesses are who might have seen the alleged behavior, and certainly what the universe of accused people are and what they have done. And then once all of this is completed, you're going to have to make a determination. And look, this can be tough. We have a slide here that tries to emphasize that. It can be a tightrope. Often you have different stories about what happened. You'll have accused people who will vehemently deny that they've done anything wrong. You'll have an accuser who will sometimes come with very strong allegations. You may not have witnesses, or you may have witnesses whose credibility is of concern to you. So you've got to weigh all of these things and decide what steps you're going to take. Sometimes interim remedial measures are important. You can suspend people, usually with pay, during the pendency of an investigation, but you do need to move promptly if you're going to do that, because that can be very disruptive and tough on morale. And so there are other things that we've touched on that are part of an investigation process, and we could spend half a day just talking about investigations and techniques, but we want to avoid retaliation. We want to preserve confidentiality to the extent we can without overpromising there, and we want to be consistent and avoid looking like we're prejudging complaints. We want to keep an open mind. And finally, we want to follow up and make sure that what we have done, our remedies are effective. And just quickly, let's recognize that we are talking about a continuum of behavior. I've looked at some of the questions that have been posed online by some of you while Dina was handling her part of the presentation, and many people were asking about this, saying, look, aren't you concerned that some of these things you're recommending are going to miss the reality that not all behaviors are equally bad and not all allegations are accurate? Absolutely. We have to realize that there are gradations of accusations. And, of course, we have to realize people are innocent until proven guilty in this country criminally. And that's generally a philosophy that most of us think is part of good management and fair play and best practices in this context as well. On this slide, we talk about horizontal factors and vertical factors. What we're really trying to get at is the idea that there are severities of accusations. You could have sexual assault, perhaps at the very top. You could have unwelcome invitations to go out on a date somewhere down below that on the continuum. And depending on the wording and the people involved, is it someone with superior power over another in the hierarchy? Is it the first complaint against the person? These things all have to be weighed in deciding what we're going to do, whether we're going to discipline someone, and how we're going to do it, because it's important to do these things proportionately. We all want to make certain that some of the questions that were put to us electronically at the beginning were getting at this notion that aren't we in danger, if we're not careful, of giving too much credit to every accusation and treating it equally so that people are deemed innocent almost immediately upon being accused, and so that we're too heavy-handed in some of our discipline. That is a concern. It's a strong concern. There's also the strong concern that it looks like or is true that we're not doing enough to help real victims. So we have to respond proportionately, and this is an intricate process that requires some thinking by people who've done it before. That's why enlist help from people in your organization who've done it and know what they're doing. Enlist help from lawyers inside and outside the company to make sure that we're doing this properly and that we're doing it consistently on a company-wide basis. Okay. Now, I want to talk about something that is one of the newest components of what we're talking about, and that's how we deal with the press, with publicity, how we deal with settlement, and then we're going to talk about final takeaways today. As we look at this, there are realities about this instant news cycle we're in that have changed the game. Traditionally, for the first 10 years of my practice, all through the 90s, most of the older lawyers that I was, the more senior lawyers, I should say, that I was reporting to, were always insistent that we decline to comment on active investigations or litigation. That was a lot easier to pull off when the newspaper came out once a day and the local news was kind of sleepy and, you know, a lot of good public interest stories, and you didn't tend to get a lot of bad publicity. And it wouldn't affect you as dramatically because people couldn't comment in big groups on it. The current climate is so different. We have this ultra-short media cycle, and it requires an updated approach. Not every lawyer agrees with this, but I certainly strongly believe this. I think most of my colleagues here at Baker Donaldson do as well. It's important to have a plan or philosophy for dealing with unwanted publicity about harassment claims. I don't think it's the best bet anymore to just wait until things happen and react. So when faced with unwanted publicity, companies should consider at a minimum doing these things, saying, first of all, in a press release or a public statement, rather than being silent, so that, you know, imagine your local news person saying, we interviewed this person, she's accused this company of allowing harassment, she's been groped at work, whatever the allegations are, and we tried to reach the company, but they declined comment. I just don't think that's where we want to be in most cases anymore. So I think at a minimum, even public companies that have to be careful about the content of what they say, particularly careful because of the rules that apply to them, at a minimum, you ought to be able to say, we don't at our company tolerate harassing or otherwise unlawful conduct. We take allegations of such conduct very seriously, and we promptly and thoroughly investigate all such allegations. And you might also consider saying something like, especially if you're a public company, you want to do this with advice from counsel, we're conducting an investigation. The accused has denied these allegations, but we're continuing to investigate. That's not a one-size-fits-all solution, but it's something to consider because what you have to realize is as you tailor your comments to the particular situation, general statements may not be enough to protect accused employees from reputational damage from unproven accusations. What about the employee? What if you've got somebody as a manager and the news cycle is saying this person groped employees and was chasing people around the office like Donald Duck in the 1950s used to chase everyone in a skirt back in those old cartoons? What happens to the manager? Often we have wanted to discourage managers from getting their own attorneys and to handle it ourselves, and we've wanted them to be like the company in no comment mode. But that may not be practical. We're in an era where if you have somebody in a community where someone is getting attacked pretty viciously, maybe it's a small community or maybe the local news is investigating with a lot of vigor, that accused manager or employee, it may not have to be a manager, may need to think about getting their own attorneys and talking about making their own statements, because we can't deny on behalf of an employee like the employee could with the same vigor. We have to be very careful to be neutral. So we're in a new world where we have to think about that, about instead of being silent, what are we going to say and what separate messaging might an employee need to make? And we should be more tolerant of that than perhaps we once were. But again, this is not a one-size-fits-all situation. Okay. Now, historically, settlements have been a way to put behind us issues that are of concern and to mitigate, to reduce our risk and know that something is not going to be in the news, not going to cost us more money. And, you know, commonly for decades that I've been practicing, we've been able to know that settlements are going to stay private. Then you've got Bill O'Reilly, and one of the first tips of the spear in this set of facts, where it came out that Fox News or O'Reilly had reached six different settlements totaling over $40 million on sexual harassment claims. And increasingly, we've seen accusers who've been paid settlements in these cases, disregarding their nondisclosure agreements and confidentiality covenants, and going public with their stories. It happened with Roger Ailes. It's happened with Bill Cosby. Some of the people who've accused him have entered settlements with him and are now ignoring those settlements and speaking out. Happened with Bill O'Reilly. It's happened with some of Harvey Weinstein's alleged victims, and with Michaela Maroney, the USA gymnast who was a gold medal gymnast. She had entered a settlement agreement with a team physician and with USA Gymnastics, and recently has come forward with allegations despite the fact she signed a settlement agreement. So what does this mean? It means these things aren't staying confidential as they once did to the same extent, but it's also interesting that the perception and the way these settlements are being characterized is changing. So I want to talk about that very briefly here. It's not the case that these things are staying confidential as often as before.
And you're seeing reporting in the media where people will report on the fact that there's been a settlement as indicating wrongdoing. And so, you know, in dealing with this, there are two things that you can do. One is consider whether a settlement is advised in the first place and reconsider whether that's the best approach. Another is to include clawback provisions, liquidated damages provisions, and other types of language in jurisdictions where this is allowed to try to make sure that if somebody breaches these non-disclosure covenants that they've entered into, that you have a chance of getting your money back. But I would say the most important thing is to have a plan in place in advance, a philosophy for dealing with when harassment settlements go public, just as you should be ready when bad publicity comes from allegations of sexual harassment. If settlements become public, you ought to have a game plan in place for that. So I want to close, and I'm going to let Dina take it from here with these takeaways that summarize what we've talked about today.
Thank you, Larry. And, you know, I guess the overall theme of what Larry and I have discussed today is really to go back and take another look. Take another look at how you're settling these claims, what is your policy, what is our culture, what are we communicating to our managers, what are we communicating to our employees, how are we training them, how are we handling complaints, are we taking, you know, making sure that they're all being taken seriously, do managers know when they're, you know, can they identify something that might be considered risky that needs to go to a higher level manager or to HR. You know, we want to make sure that we're controlling the media message and that we're not trying to cover something up that we've had. If we've had multiple complaints about a key employee, that we are looking at that and asking ourselves, do we need to do something about that? So, you know, overall, it's in this climate, we don't, you know, there is a climate right now that is saying, that is demanding that employers, when they hear of this and they know of it or they should have known of it, do something. And so you're going to see a push for that. And given that climate, you definitely want to take another look. We're going to stick around just for a couple minutes and answer questions, but we so appreciate everyone being here today. There is a survey, and we ask that and appreciate you filling it out for us so we can know what we're doing right and what you'd like to hear from the L&E group at Baker going forward. But thank you all for being here. Larry, I think one of the questions I thought was really interesting and probably one that a lot of people have is what happens when we've got a he said, she said? And, you know, and do we err on the side of protecting the company's interests and firing them if we don't know? What do you think?
I think it has to be decided on a case-by-case basis. In that instance, I've had situations where clients have not been sure who was telling the truth and in an abundance of caution have let both employees go. I've had more situations where the company has kept both employees and tried to manage through it, perhaps by separating them and putting the accuser in a position where they're not feeling as vulnerable. But there is not a one-size-fits-all approach to this. There can't be, because every situation is so nuanced. And that's where I think circling the wagons, talking to your subject matter experts at your company, talking to your outside attorneys can really help you come up with a tailored solution for that scenario.
Yeah, I agree. And also, you know, we want to look at the accuser, you know, the accused rights. If we don't know for sure and let's say that it turns out not to be true, you know, is it possible that we might have some ramifications of terminating this person? So it's definitely something, yeah. I agree with you, that we have to look at on a case-by-case situation. And, you know, a couple people asked about, and I think Larry commented on this, about old complaints, you know, and it's remarkable to me how many people are coming forward alleging things that happened 15, 20 years ago now, because I believe this Me Too and Time's Up move, you know, both of these movements are sort of encouraging that, you know, if you've suffered from this in the past, speak up. And so that puts employers in a very difficult situation. What if the harasser or witnesses, alleged harasser or witnesses are gone. You know, how do you investigate these things? And,
instance, though, wouldn't you say, Dina, a rare instance when both employees get punished, it would involve back and forth allegations of wrongdoing by both parties. Generally, the accused is going to be someone who's going to be protected, and the accuser is going to be protected, and the accused may be subject to discipline or even termination, even if you can't become comfortable as the decision maker about whether it absolutely happened. We're not looking for proof beyond a shadow of a doubt here. We're looking for good risk management and good best practices. Often we will have incomplete answers, don't you think?
Absolutely, absolutely. And I think you really have to look at, as Larry talked about, that continuum, that vertical and horizontal continuum. We're going to look at what's the allegation, what is the behavior that the person is alleging or conduct that they are alleging happened, and then we're going to look at the other factors. What's the relationship between the two people? Is this a disgruntled employee that's been, we've been talking about terminating and they're all of a sudden bringing this forward? We got to look at the circumstances, and all of this is part about weighing in and weighing the evidence before you that you sometimes have to do in these cases, that you do have a he said she said situation. And then when we have these older complaints that come forward of things that happened many years ago, as Larry said, you want to investigate them, but it's going to be to the extent you're able to. I mean, in some cases, you're going to have, that you might just not be able to get much information on it because employees have left or been terminated. I think you need to take them all seriously, particularly if the employees are still employed. But, you can only do what you can do. We've had a couple people ask this question, Larry, and I think this is because we've had a couple people ask it. I think I think we should address it, and it's a good one. How much do you share with both the accuser and the accused after the investigation? What do you tell them about it? Because we want, we definitely want to communicate, especially to the person who has made the allegations, our findings and what we're going to do about it. So what do you think, Larry, in terms of communications?
I think it's important to try to give the accuser as much comfort as you can while still being mindful of fairness and confidentiality on the other side. But at a minimum, if you're going to take action, if it's as simple as separating them or putting these people on different shifts, the accuser needs to know that. If appropriate action is taken, I think usually you don't go into detail about the specifics of the discipline. That's almost never done. But telling the accuser that appropriate action has been taken and emphasizing that if anything else occurs, they should come immediately to designated people to renew their complaint because we don't allow retaliation, that's especially important no matter what. And, of course, with the accused, if you have a remedial action you're taking, that accused needs to know that and needs to be well documented. If, on the other hand, you get in a he said, she said stalemate, you still need to have some record of what you told the accused about what they should and should not do and what's expected of them going forward and how we do not tolerate harassing behavior. We need to make that statement to them and we need to document it.
Absolutely, and also, my practice is to when I conduct these investigations or I'm advising clients on it, is that we don't disclose what witnesses have said to us. We're more than likely these people are going to be continuing to work together, and we want to, in an effort to protect and encourage people to participate in investigations and to come forward with complaints. To the extent we're able to, we really want to try to keep that information confidential. Somebody asked if lawsuits are public. Yes, lawsuits are public. So once somebody makes an allegation in a lawsuit, anybody can go and get a copy of that lawsuit and read the allegations to it, which is what I think Larry was referring to when he was talking about this new age of the news cycle and social media, where you know, besides just going to the press, that employees can actually, you know, use social media with information that can have a damaging effect on your organization. So that's something you definitely want to manage. Larry, I'm sorry, I'm having some technical difficulty on getting these questions. Can you find another? For some reason, I can't scroll right now.
There are a couple of these. An earlier question asked what to do if someone who has left the company accuses someone who's at the company. Another said, what do we do if someone who is still at the company accuses someone who is now gone from the company? I still think we investigate and try to find out if misbehaviors occurred and try to address it, even if the alleged harasser has left the company. Likewise, if someone has left the company already, we want to conduct an internal investigation into those allegations, but often I don't recommend communicating with that ex-employee about what you've done, because as one of the questioners asked, they said, I did this. The person said, great, you've proved my case, and the ex-employee then went to the EEOC. And so the question was, it almost felt to me like I made her case for her. So you have to be careful when the person who's the accuser has already left about your messaging, and always about your messaging, because you don't want to give people confirmation that they have a claim if it's non-obvious. But you also want to take appropriate steps, especially if people still at the company, to let them know that you've addressed the situation and what recourse they have, to know they're protected and that it shouldn't happen again. So it can be a balance, somewhat delicate balance. I do think it's important to be more cautious with what you communicate to people who've left you.
Thank you, Larry. Well, our 10 minutes went quickly, and our time's up, and we want to thank everybody for sticking around. And you will get a thank you with the slides that have both our emails and our phone numbers, or if you have another Baker Donaldson L&E attorney you work with, please feel free to reach out to them if you have any questions or we can be of help in any way. But thank you, everyone, for being here.
Yes. Thank you very much.